before telling you about the project, let me briefly remind you what quantum communication is. So somehow, abstractly, one could define quantum communication as the art of transferring of quantum state from one location, Alice, to a distant location, Bob. So you start by having a quantum state somewhere, and at the end of the process, this quantum state is at the other side. Now, why should you be interested in that? The interest comes from the fact that a quantum state cannot be copied. So the original is necessarily destroyed, as I have illustrated here, but also there remains no copy nowhere. So you immediately have the idea that if you cannot have a copy, that's excellent for cryptography, because if I want to send some confidential information, I want this information to get in the hands of my partner and no one else. So here we have somehow the intuition behind quantum cryptography, or more precisely, quantum key distribution. And maybe one more word, why are physicists so much convinced about this, what is called a quantum no-cloning theorem? And the reason is really very strong. Namely, if we could copy quantum states, that would violate Heisenberg's uncertainty relation. You could make a copy and then measure position on one and momentum on the copy. But it would also allow to use entanglement for faster than light signaling. So the impossibility of quantum cloning is really one of the best established facts of today's science. So how do you do quantum communication? Again, abstractly, it's quite easy. You take a photon, you send this photon on a beam splitter, and after the beam splitter, the photon exploits both paths, encounters two detectors, but only one detector will click. So here you have the fact that the photon explores two possible paths, that is, comes under the name of quantum non-locality or entanglement, and the fact that only one of the two detectors detect the photon. This is quantum randomness. So these are the two ingredients that we need for QKD. So this is something which is now, from the scientific, pure science point of view, well mastered, and there is already some application. So for instance, ID Quantique, this partner, spin-off of our university, 10 years old. This is a quantum random number generator. This is 4 centimeter in size. And that's how Alice and Bob look like. And the good news is that we already have some customers that take that seriously. Now, there are also some limitations. If you look, first of all, this box only produces a key that then has to be used for some cryptographic applications. So the complete system looks a bit more complicated. You have these Alice and Bob, the black boxes, and these black boxes produce these keys, which are then used by the blue boxes. The blue boxes are encryptors. So this is a classical box that just does encryption. And they come from a company called Senetas in Australia for the time being. And the idea of this QCrypt project is to do all that much better, and in particular, much faster. So for instance, today's systems here run at 5 megabits per second, or megapulses per second, and we want to go to 1.25 gigabits per second. Also, the encryptors, they run today between 2 and 10 gigabits, and they should, at the end of this project, run between 40 and 100 megabits per second. Moreover, we want to have only one fiber connecting both sides. So the vision of this QCrypt project is secure high-speed communication for the 21st century. So how do you do that? There are several steps in developing such a thing. The first thing is to have the good idea how you're going to implement these abstract ideas of no cloning and things like that. And there are some protocols for that, and there is one which is pretty well known. Maybe you heard once of the BB84 protocol. That's, I would say, the historical protocol, which was really thought about by theorists talking in the language of qubits and Hilbert spaces and like that. So let me show you now one system that we invented and patented, which is clearly much closer to communication in optical fibers. So we start with a laser in continuous mode, and thanks to some intensity modulator, we cut off of this continuous wave pulses. Now, some pulses, the ones that are here white, are just empty pulses. So empty pulses, you just block the light. That's pretty easy, at least in principle. And then we have the non-empty pulses, but these non-empty pulses have actually only less than one photon on average. That starts to sound quantum. And then we just decide of some simple coding scheme. So for instance, this sequence of a pair would code for a zero, and this sequence would code for a one. Now on the receiving side, you simply have a single photon detector that can detect whether the arrival time is even and odd, or odd, and then you know whether you had a zero or a one. Now that would not yet be sufficient, because in quantum physics, in order to get this security, you have to also do something which we call a measurement in another basis, which in practice is done by taping a little bit of this light, let's say 10%, and going to the conjugated basis to a photon number, which will involve some phases. So we have an interferometer with a long arm and a short arm, in such a way that at this point, the two possible successive, let's say for instance, these two successive pulses will interfere, and if there is no adversary trying to measure the number of photons in our pulses, we should get 100% visibility here, which means the photon goes entirely to this detector and never to the other detector. So that's the quantum security in this. Okay, so now in order to work on that, we have these different components, so the laser, the modulator, the attenuator on one side, and then at the other side, here it is a Michelson interferometer, not a Mach Zehnder, but it's the same principle, and then the single photon detectors. So in conclusion, quantum optics offers true randomness and intrinsic confidentiality, this impossibility of copying. And so it is natural to try to exploit these gifts of nature. The goal of this project is the secure high-speed communication for the 21st century. And compared to existing systems, we want to gain 2 to 3 orders of magnitude with this about more than 1 gigabit per second on the quantum level, and 0.1 in order to introduce the word tera bits per second on the classical level. And the project is complex because it involves all these different partners. It involves advanced classical optics, world-level high-rate single photon detection, world-level fast cryptographic algorithms. I didn't mention here, but there's also all the algorithms for error correction, which, by the way, will be done now at EPFL, and highly non-trivial interfaces. Also, the interface looks like nothing, but everybody who knows a bit of the field will realize that the contribution of this HOS for the interfaces will be greatly appreciated. Thank you.